If you're looking to reduce odors in your home, you might have searched for an air freshener like Febreze. But when you type it into the search, the results might scare you. You may see a list of websites that say Febreze is full of toxic chemicals, that it contains air contaminants, and it's harmful to pets. Oh, did I mention the claims that it's linked to cancer? But is all this true? We're gonna talk about some of the claims that are out there, and then you get to decide for yourself. This video is sponsored by Procter & Gamble, the company who makes Febreze. They flew me out to Cincinnati so I can speak with their scientists and check out their labs. Although this video is paid for, my opinion is not, and it's fully my own. If you're a regular viewer on this channel, then you already know, surprise, everything is made of chemicals. This sofa, these flowers, this apple, claims that you can live a chemical-free life are just untrue. There are no alternatives to chemicals, just choices about which chemicals to use and how they're made. So let's talk about toxic chemicals. Now, if I offered you this apple, you'd probably eat it, and why not? You know it's non-toxic and all natural. But now, what if I told you it had formaldehyde? Would you still eat it? Probably not, even though that statement is true. In addition to the hundreds of natural chemicals you're exposing yourself to every time you eat an apple, you're also eating between 1 and 6 milligrams of naturally occurring formaldehyde. So why don't we die of toxicity? Because the conversation isn't about whether a chemical is toxic or not, it's about the dose or the amount of the chemical you're exposed to. Let's take something as natural as sunlight. Too much and you risk a sunburn, or even skin cancer. Too little and your body can't produce the vitamin D it needs to keep bones healthy. So the answer is moderation. In the case of formaldehyde, at high levels, it can be toxic, but at low levels, it's a necessary part of our body and it can be used to make amino acids and DNA. Good news for chemical watchers, Febreze doesn't have formaldehyde, phthalates, or many of the other ingredients on people's no-fly list. But even if it did, I wouldn't be too concerned because it's the dose that makes the poison. So what if Febreze are people claiming is toxic? Some people say Febreze puts contaminants into the air, but just because a chemical is present doesn't mean it's unsafe. You wanna know what else produces contaminants? Roses. The natural smell of roses puts hundreds of chemical compounds into the air. These are known as volatile organic compounds, and although some VOCs are harmful, the ones found in roses and Febreze are totally safe. Before Febreze goes into stores, scientists find the chemical's safe dose, a level where no effects are seen on a wide array of people, even the most sensitive types of people. Then they set the limit they use for their products anywhere from 100 to 1,000 times below that. They call that the product's safe limit. This limit is constantly monitored in the face of any consumer complaints or new data. I learned over 500 PhD scientists at Procter & Gamble work to ensure product safety. It's a big deal for them. I've been to the labs and the amount of effort that goes into testing products for effectiveness, irritation, and safety is pretty impressive. Impressive. It's a big operation, not two guys stuffed in a basement somewhere who never get invited to the company party. When I first saw websites claiming Febreze harmed cats and dogs, I thought, maybe that's possible. After all, animals have smaller body weights and may be more sensitive to the smaller doses of chemicals that don't really affect humans. However, veterinary toxicology experts at the National Animal Poison Control Center and the American Veterinary Medical Association called the claims false, saying contrary to rumors being spread over the internet, there is no substantiated evidence that the use of Febreze causes the death of any dogs or cats. Typical of most urban legends, the allegations that Febreze is dangerous are accompanied with vague claims of pets dying or becoming ill. Just remember, there's a big difference between my pet died after using Febreze versus my pet died because of Febreze. The same goes for cancer. When I hear an ingredient is linked to cancer, I get a little skeptical. It's tempting to assume one variable causes another, but just because a chemical is present when a disease occurs does not mean it caused it. It reminds me of one of my favorite cartoons where a man realizes that everyone who's ever gone to the moon has eaten chicken. He concludes, "Chicken makes you go to the moon." I'm not saying that concerns about links to cancer or disease should be ignored, but they do deserve the same skepticism as bold product claims. When I look into claims that an ingredient has done something horrible, I often find a single study in a lab using massive and unrealistic amounts of an ingredient. Let's take California's Prop 65, which is so inclusive that it made coffee shops label coffee as a carcinogen. No, an occasional coffee will not cause your cells to suddenly multiply out of control. My evidence, the American Cancer Society. And my addiction to Starbucks. So why am I telling you all of this? Because I believe consumers should make informed decisions, and I want to provide the information that helps make that possible. Frankly, I'm also getting a little tired of the toxic hysteria that seems to surround every product I look at. If you feel the same way, click that like button. If you find you just don't like fragrance products, that's okay. Maybe Febreze isn't for you, but make the decision based off of facts, not false accusations that someone else wants you to believe. Now that we talked about safety, let's get to the next big question. Does Febreze really work? Share what you think in the comment section below. Then join me in the next video. Click subscribe or you might miss it.